Okay, so liver fibrosis is characterized by the activation of hepatic stellate cells, here in yellow, and can be controlled by both innate and adaptive immunity. Our group is interested in the interaction between CD4 T cell subset and hepatic stellate cells because individuals infected with HIV, which have altered CD4 T cell function, progress more rapidly through liver fibrosis. Briefly, Th1 cells are considered antifibrotic because the secretion of interferon gamma can block the response to stellate cells to the major profibrotic signal like TGF-beta. On the other hand, Th2 cells can directly activate hepatic stellate cells through secretion of IL-4 and IL-13. Regulatory T cells can inhibit liver fibrosis through secretion of IL-10, which induces senescence of activated stellate cells. And IL-10 was used in clinical trial to limit liver fibrosis, but no significant effects were obtained, meaning that other pathways can counteract its action or will be necessary to stop fibrosis in patients. Finally, Th17 cell, which produce IL-17 and are pro-inflammatory, has been linked to liver fibrosis progression, but whether or not they can directly activate hepatic stellate cells remain poorly understood. But what is known is that IL-17, along with the Th2 cytokine, can activate macrophages and monocytes, and to activate them to produce more pro-inflammatory and pro-fibrotic cytokine, including TGF-beta. So coming back to the Th17 cell, what is known is that Th17 cells are increased in the liver of patients with advanced fibrosis as compared to patients with lower fibrosis, meaning that IL-17A could be linked to liver fibrosis progression. So the aim of this study was to identify whether or not IL-17A could directly activate hepatic stellate cells and to identify which cellular pathways are involved in this phenotype. So we developed a model based on the human hepatic stellate cell line, LX2 cells, that we stimulated with cytokine. And after 48 hours of stimulation, we looked at the expression of profibrotic gene by qPCR, so mainly smooth muscle actin, collagen type 1, and TIMP1. And we validated the expression by Western blot for smooth muscle actin and TIMP1. And for collagen type 1, we performed picrocyte thread staining. Finally, we did flow cytometry experiments to look for the expression of the TGF-beta receptor and the IL-17 receptor. So first, here our control. So the first line of the Western blot is PBS-treated cells. They do not express TIMP1, smooth muscle actin, and cannot produce collagen type 1 and are quiescent cells. Then we use two doses of TGF-beta as positive control, a low dose which cannot activate stellate cells, as you can see here by Western blot or picrocyte thread staining, and a high dose, so this is the first line, which fully activates stellate cell with strong production of TIMP1, smooth muscle actin, and collagen type 1. Then when we checked for IL-17, we use also two doses, a low dose, which we can measure in the plasma of patient, and a high dose, which is non-physiological. And as you can see, at both doses, IL-17A couldn't activate hepatic stellate cells. However, when we combine IL-17 to the suboptimal doses of TGF-beta, we observe robust and strong activation of the stellate cells with high production of TIMP1, alpha smooth muscle actin, and collagen type 1, meaning that there might have a synergistic effect between IL-17 cytokine, and TGF-beta. So we validated those results using primary human stellate cells. And as you can see here, light in orange, we observed the same phenotype. When cell was stimulated with IL-17A and suboptimal doses of TGF-beta, we observed robust activation of the stellate cells. So the first conclusion is that IL-17A cannot directly activate stellate cells and that TGF-beta is required, and there is a synergy between those two cytokines. So we hypothesized that this could be due to modulation of the TGF-beta receptor. So we did flow cytometry experiment where we looked at the TGF-beta receptor expression. So here in dark gray is the expression by quiescent hepatic stellate cells. When we stimulated the cell with TGF-beta, we observed the decrease in the receptor expression, which is a known feedback mechanism. Interestingly, when we stimulated cell with IL-17A, we observed an increase in the TGF-beta cell surface expression. Finally, IL-17A could prevent the decrease in the TGF-beta receptor observed when cell was stimulated with TGF-beta, meaning that the cell could respond for a longer period of time to TGF-beta. And finally, we did not observe any significant modulation of the IL-17 receptor upon cytokine stimulation. Also, this increase in the TGF-beta receptor cell surface expression was linked to increased signaling. So when cells were treated with TGF-beta, the suboptimal doses, we did not observe any significant phosphorylation of SMAD2-3. But when cells were stimulated with high dose of TGF-beta, we observed strong phosphorylation of SMAD2 and 3, which was mostly localized in the cytoplasm. Interestingly, when cells were stimulated with IL-17A and then stimulated with suboptimal doses of TGF-beta, we observed strong phosphorylation of SMAD2 and 3, which was mostly localized in the nucleus of the cell. So IL-17A increases nuclear translocation and phosphorylation of SMAD2 and 3. So we wanted to know which cellular pathway could be involved in this phenotype. And IL-17A can activate four pathways. And looking at the literature, we found that when GNK is activated, you can see increased phosphorylation and nuclear translocation of the phospho-SMAD, and this is what we observed. So we first confirmed by Western blood that IL-17A was capable of activating the GNK pathway. Then using chemical inhibitor, here comparing the blue, which is in the absence of the chemical inhibitor, and orange, in presence of the chemical inhibitor, you can see that when we block the activation of GNK, we lose our phenotype of increased TIMP1 and smooth muscle production by stellate cells in response to suboptimal doses of TGF-beta. We also, in presence of junk inhibitor, lose the upregulation of the TGF-beta receptor observed when cells were treated with IL-17A. And this correlated, here again, comparing the blue and the orange, in the loss of the increased phosphorylation of SMAD2-3 in response to suboptimal doses of TGF-beta. So in conclusion, what we demonstrated is that hepatic stellate cell can respond to IL-17A and will upregulate at the cell surface the expression of the TGF-beta receptor 2 in a junk-dependent manner. This will allow hepatic stellate cell to respond to suboptimal doses of TGF-beta, and we will see increased phosphorylation of SMAD2 and 3, which will be further enhanced by the activation of GNK. We will also observe increased nuclear translocation, which will also be dependent of the activation of GNK, which will lead to increased transcription of profibrotic gene and increased fibrosis. Finally, also, stellate cells in response to IL-17A produce chemokine, which are important in the recruitment of pro-inflammatory macrophages that will be further activated by IL-17A to produce more profibrotic cytokine, including TGF-beta, showing that IL-17A is a key profibrotic cytokine. So to that, I would like to thank the organizer to let me present my work today, my mentor, Nagla Shukri, our collaborator, Scott Friedman, the member of my laboratory, and the NCRTP. And I will be happy to answer any question.